Hello and welcome back to CIS165 JavaScript Programming. I'm Victor Campos. Well, it's just about that time now. The final project is upon us. So let me show you what we'll be creating together, which will segue us into the final project of the class. So I've got a project here. The horror movie database. So we have like a splash screen, and then there was a timer that then faded into the main home screen here. So this is, of course, also jQuery mobile, so that we can quickly create an interface that looks nice. I've got already some data here, show. And what I get here is a list of some horror movies. So it's a table. It's data in a table about a movie. Oh, I made a little misspelling there, so okay, I can click the pencil that pops up here so I can spell that properly. Update. That's been fixed. Oh, and I guess maybe the Snoopy movie really isn't a horror movie, so I will choose to delete that movie, and it's deleted. So you're seeing here that this data in this table that existed, I can manipulate it. I can also save a new movie. So let's say I wanted to save the movie. I'm going to use the code FR13A. That's for Friday the 13th, part 1. It wasn't called part 1 back in the day, but we'll call it part 1. And that one was from 1980. We'll save that. See how I'm getting this feedback as well, a movie saved. And it got saved to the table. So all of this is the culmination of our class, and we're going to learn one more new thing, PouchDB, which is a way to save more complex database information. It's JSON-based, so that will harken us back to a previous lesson where we talked about JSON. But now we're able to save more data in the project and retrieve it and so forth. And with jQuery Mobile, we can make these interfaces, such as delete everything. I don't want to delete it all at the moment, but I could to start over. So this is what our project will be. And let me back up again to show at the very beginning, there's a splash screen that displays for a few seconds. And then automatically takes us to the main screen. So that's what we'll be working on. I'm going to set up a brand new folder project as always. We can call it Lesson 15 Final, I suppose. I'm going to bring in a copy of the basic file. And then I'll start up Visual Studio Code and set myself up. So I'm going to fill in that this is my final project. Practice. This final project with a focus on PouchDB for saving data. It'll be due on the last day of class, which is December the 9th. 2016. So I'm going to set this up to use jQuery Mobile just like before. So after the meta tag of car set, we'll add the meta tag name, viewport, content, user scalable. No, comma, initial dash scale equals 1, and width is device width. That'll make us mobile friendly. Next, I need to bring in the jQuery and jQuery mobile code libraries from the web. So if I go over to jQueryMobile.com, over to the custom download, link to the CDN version. I need the link to the CSS file. Up on the head section. We'll do that before our custom style. And then I need the references over to jQuery and jQuery Mobile. So I'll do that before my custom CSS, custom JavaScript. And the last piece of the puzzle is if you go to pouchdb.com. PouchDB, the database that syncs. PouchDB is an open source JavaScript database inspired by Apache CouchDB that is designed to run well within the browser. PouchDB was created to help web developers build apps that work as well offline as they do online. It enables applications to store data locally while offline, then synchronize it with CouchDB and compatible servers when the application is back online, keeping the user's data in sync no matter where they next log on. So basically, it's a database. And if you notice the example code here, it's all based on JavaScript. So we're going to create a database with the PouchDB object. We're going to put data to the database in JSON format. Notice the curly braces. We'll be able to have various methods such as changes, when the database changes, do something. And then if we want to get really complex, we can replicate our data to a server. We're not going to get to that point because the server is out of the scope of this class, but we will be able to create databases that are more complex than ever before. This is a project that is always being updated on a regular basis. Reach out to the developers. They're very cool people. They'll answer your questions. And so what we want for our class is to link to the CDN version of the library, and then we'll learn how to use it together. The full documentation, of course, is at pouchdb.com. You should check that out on your own if you want to learn even more. For the class, I'll click Download. I'm using 6.0.7. It may change by the time you work on it. It actually just changed one day before I started this lesson. And so what we need is, if you scroll down under Quick Start, there's a little bit of a snippet of what we need. I need to grab that script declaration there. Make sure you copy the start and end of the script. Back to our code. So this will be after jQuery Mobile, but before our custom code. Paste that in. Maybe clean it up a little bit. I'm going to move that ending script tag to the same line. And I also want to add the HTTP portion here. If you don't have that, it might not fully work, because without HTTP, it assumes that your project is on a web server. Right now, we're not on a web server, so it's safest to put HTTP. So we're connected to pouchdb.min.js over on the jsdeliver.net server. So now we have the ability to create PouchDB databases. We're going to write a lot of extensive JavaScript here. In total, the project should be around 350 lines of HTML, JavaScript, and CSS in one file. So our starting code here, we're going to use the jQuery iffy. That's dollar parentheses. Then function, parentheses, curly braces. Break those curly braces, and we'll use strict mode, as always. So we're going to write a lot of JavaScript, jQuery Mobile, and PouchDB code here. But before that, we'll set up an interface. I'm going to back up. We won't need this heading one. I'm going to create the splash screen that we see first. So that'll be a section. So section, end section, data role, page. an ID of splash. This is our splash screen. We're going to only use an article. We don't need a header like we used previously. Role of main and class of UI-content. What I want to display in this screen is an image. It needs a source. And I've got a temporary image to work with. https://vmcink.files.wordpress.com/2016/11/8od. That's an O, not a zero. .jpg. JPG. Alt text here. This is the Army of Darkness poster. And a class so that we can edit it a bit with CSS. Call it image splash. If I take a quick look at what that looks like so far, it's a big ol' image, which then we'll fix with some CSS. So backing up to the CSS block, we've got the class of image splash. Just a simple width of 100% fixes up our image so that it's as big as the screen. A tall, thin screen like a mobile device. I'll display some text below it. So that'll be a heading 1 of horror movie database. That would be nice centered as well. So if we add a class, h1 splash, we can then create a CSS class of h1 splash and a text dash align property and value of center. So here's my splash screen. This will display first for a little while and then move us automatically over to the main home screen. I'm going to start setting up that home screen first before I actually do the timer to take us from the splash screen to the home screen. So that'll be a new section. And it's got a data role, page, an ID of home. I will use a header this time. Data role, header, data position, fixed so that it doesn't scroll away. And this will be a heading 1. That will display HMDB, the horror movie database. An article. Role. Main. Class UI-content. This is our standard jQuery mobile setup. For the moment, I'll just put an H2 here. Hello. That's going to be filled in much more complexly in a little bit. But I just want to then finish up the footer area. Data role. Footer. Data position fixed so it doesn't scroll away. It stays at the bottom of the screen. For the moment, I won't put anything just yet in the footer. Just a little placeholder there, but we'll change that. And I want an A tag for options. So this section is independent of the splash screen section. If I try to view it in the browser, there's no way for me to go from the splash screen to the home screen. So what I want to do is set up automatically after a certain amount of time for this to fade away and then show me my home section. So let's do a little bit of JavaScript. So after use strict, we have a plain old JavaScript command which will set a timer, and after it counts down, it does something. So we'll create a var, an object of splash screen, equal to set timeout, the set timeout method. We're going to say after the time runs out, we will show home. This is a function, but we don't use the parentheses here. It's just the name of the function, show home. And after the timer runs out, which let's start off with 5,000 milliseconds, let's say after 5 seconds, we will run show home. Well, then we need to define show home. So function show home. Once the timer runs out, we also want to make sure we've deactivated the timer. Clear timeout. Which timer? The splash screen timer. It's going to run out of time, but it's basically going to be still running in the background. We want to clear it. And then what we want to do is move over from the splash section to the home section. We can use jQuery Mobile to do that programmatically rather than having to click something interactively. So we start out with $, that's jQuery.mobile. And yes, this looks very different than other jQuery that we've done before. We just have to learn to do it like this. There's a few instances where our syntax looks like this. .navigate. So basically, we're invoking jQuery, specifically jQuery mobile objects, specifically the navigate method. And that means we're going to go over to the home screen. So after our time runs out, 5 seconds, move us over to the home screen. Let's check that out. I'm going to be checking this in Chrome. So I'm going to refresh. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, go. There it is. Here's our home screen, very incomplete, but at least it moved us there. Back up again, refresh that if you want. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, go. All right, so 5 seconds is going to take too long. That's just to show you it should work. I'm going to cut it down to 3 seconds. The splash screen is something nice to look at while all of these other JavaScript libraries are loading up. Then it'll go off here to home. So 3 seconds is probably enough. 1, 2, 3, go. There it is. Okay, so we've got a home screen. I'm going to fix up the footer. I do want options down in the footer, but I want the option button to be moved to the right and only have an icon. So back on line 34. This will be href going off to pound options, which doesn't exist yet. Data icon of gear. I want a little gear icon. Data dash icon pos, the position of the icon so that we can say no text. Data dash transition. Pop. And to move it to the right, we have a class of UI dash btn dash right. This moves our icon to the right side of the footer. I don't want anything really visible down in the footer. I'll put an empty space, but I can't really put an empty space in HTML. I have to put the entity ampersand NBSP semicolon. So that'll be rendered as an empty space. And the icon is down on the corner. That's going to open an about screen. So that's going to open an options/about screen. So I'll finish that up quickly. After the section of home, create a new section. Data role. Page. But data dialog. True. And the ID of options. Header, data role, header, and a heading 1, which we can call this screen options. Add an article, role. Main class UI content. For the assignment, you will fill in something interesting here. Something interesting. And we'll also have a mechanism to delete all data. So that's going to be a button. href to nowhere, and then we're going to tap into a class here. Rather than using data role equals button, data icon equals whatever, we can use another syntax in jQuery mobile that gives us different features. ui-btn space ui-corner dash all space ui-btn-b space ui-shadow and then an ID. We'll call this btn nuke. This will delete all of our data, so it's very powerful. Once we create that section, we should then be able to access it via the button. So if I refresh my work, I have this little button. Here's our options screen, delete all data, it doesn't do anything yet. You may find a little quirk here that if you refresh and then open your options, did you see it went away? Well, that's our timer that's still in play. See, it goes away. So don't be alarmed if that goes away. For testing purposes, don't worry about it. But subsequent times after that, it doesn't go away. It's just that the timer is still active. All right, so back to the main screen here. We've got a lot to fill in here. That hello text was just temporary. I'm going to remove it. Instead, I'll create a div container, data role. Collapsible. We haven't seen this one yet. Data dash collapsed dash icon equals caret dash u. Now that's C-A-R-A-T, caret, like 24 caret. You know, not caret as in what Bugs Bunny eats. Caret pointing up. It's like an arrow. Then we've got data dash expanded dash icon equals caret d for down, and data dash collapsed equals false. So this is sort of like a drawer that opens up, and we've got the drawer uncollapsed, data collapsed equals false, which is open. The drawer is open, and we have an icon that we have set up for when the drawer is closed or collapsed. It'll be the caret pointing up. And when the drawer is open or expanded, it'll be the caret pointing down. is a drawer that will then display a form of information you're going to save. So then we need a heading here as part of this collapsible element. This will be save a movie. Our database will save a list of horror movies. So that's going to be a form of information that we'll accept. We'll add a class to the form so we can style it a bit. UI-body space UI-body-A space UI-corner-all. So that's jQuery Mobile to style this form element, and then an ID so that we can reference it, form movie. We'll create three input fields. So we need a label, code. I'll explain that in a moment. This label is for field code, and it's an input field of type text with a placeholder AOD, for example. The name is field code, and its ID is field code. Break that. I'm going to need two of the same, so I'm going to copy and paste this to save myself a little bit of effort. And so next I need field name. The name then is field name, and the ID is field name. Placeholder is Army of Darkness, and the visible text of the label is name. And for the third label, we have field year. The label will display year. Input type number will only accept the number in this field. Placeholder 1992, name field year, and ID field year. Let's see what this looks like. So home screen, we've got this element of collapsible, which is open, save a movie. That can be opened and closed. We can close it to look at our data. Uncluttered, we can open it when we want to save the data. So the point of this is that we're going to save a variety of horror movies. They have a name and they have a year. They also need a unique code to identify them in the database. I can save thousands of movies. And the way that they will be separate from each other, each record is separate from a separate record, is a code. The code is a unique field in our data that cannot be shared by anything else. So if I'm saving the movie Army of Darkness, it has code AOD. I cannot save any other movie with a code of AOD. That's how we differentiate each movie in the database, by unique code. We can make this up whatever we want. Obviously, I can put gibberish here, gibberish here. Here, depending on your browser, it should only accept numbers. So I can put any numbers here. Obviously, that's not a real number yet. But we're going to be able to save this kind of data. We want buttons to clear this data if we want to start over, a button to save this data, and then a button to show the data that we've saved. So after this label, next line, we'll create another div, class UI-grid-b. This is a jQuery mobile class. so that we can create a three column grid. Grid A is two columns, grid B is three columns, grid C is four columns, etc. Each particular cell is another div with a class of UI-block-A. That's the first cell of the first row. I'm going to copy that, paste it two more times, and then UI-block-B and block-C. Between these divs, we'll have item 1. This is just temporary. Item 2, item 3. This is just to show you that here this creates a grid of equally spaced items in the same row, nicely divided. What will be in each of these divs is a button. So input type reset button. Value of reset, ID btn reset, another input of type button, value save, ID btn save, there's our save button. And then an input of type button, value show. This will show all of our movies that we've saved. ID btn show, close that. And the result is a reset, save, and show button. Reset does work at this point. We'll improve it in a bit. Save doesn't do anything, and neither does show, of course. Show will display a table of all of the movies we've saved. So we need a placeholder to display that on screen. After the collapsible element, I want to display a div placeholder. ID div show. We will show our table there. Now I also want to give the user some feedback when they save a class, delete a class, etc. I want pop-ups, some basic pop-ups to appear to give the user some feedback. I have to create the content of these pop-ups in the same article where I'm calling them. So after the div of collapsible and the div of show, we'll create another div. I'll keep this on a single line because it'll be rather basic. But this div will say movie saved. The trick then is data role pop-up class UI-content. And then ID, to summon it, we'll call this pop saved. So I'm going to copy and paste that. This will be then movie erased. Pop deleted. I'll call it movie deleted instead. Doesn't matter, but to keep it straight in my mind. Movie deleted, pop deleted, the rest is the same. And because I know that we could have some possible errors, I will add three more pop-ups, but these are for errors. We'll say error, fill all fields. We require all of those fields to be filled in order for us to save a movie. We can have another error. Movie already saved. This has to do with the unique code of each movie. You have to have a unique code every time. And then an error of movie does not exist. We're going to have a mechanism to delete a movie, but if we try to delete a movie that doesn't exist, well, we get an error. And then each of these needs a unique ID, so I'll call them pop error code, pop error dupe, and pop error null. If the movie I'm trying to delete doesn't exist, it's null. If I'm trying to save the same movie that exists, it's a duplicate. And if I don't fill every field, I didn't fill in the proper code. So if I check my work, none of those pop-ups appear, of course. But when I click save, I should get movie saved eventually. If I were to delete a movie, I would get that result. And if I were getting any errors, I get the other pop-ups. So let's set up the mechanism to take the data that the user has saved into those fields and insert them into the database. This is going to be JavaScript. So after our splash screen, I'm going to create various jQuery-based objects so that I can interact with the app. Var $lFormMovie equals to $poundFormMovie. That, of course, is the form that we've created up here to take all of the information that the user has saved. So we're going to create a reference to that whole object. Comma LBTN reset. That is our BTN reset button. LBTN save. That is our BTN save button. LBTN show. That's BTN show. The button itself. And then LDiv show is from PouchDB show. End of line. So that creates references to those various elements that exist in the HTML. Check your spelling. And after this, I'll create event handlers. So if we have LBTN reset, we want an on method, on click, comma. We will invoke the function fn clear form. Doesn't exist yet, but we'll get to it. Then we want lbtn save on click, the function save movie. LBTN show on click function show movies. Be careful about your plurals here. I'm calling this function show movies. Previously is function save movie. Best practice is to leave these event handlers as the last code in the script block. So now we can define function fn clear form. And so we'll say the L form movie, the zeroth item of the list, reset. Console log form cleared. All right, that's clear form. Then I need to define save movie and show movies. Function fn save movie and function fn show movies. I need to do this or else jQuery will complain. If I check my code at this point, I'm going to need to bring up my console now. Might get a little bit tight. So as I start to type something and then I click the reset button, it resets. It resets and I get some console output. Nothing special. What's special will be save movies, and what will be even more special is show movies. All right. So to save a movie, we need to collect the three pieces of data that were supplied in the form. The unique code that identifies the movie, the name of the movie, and the year of the movie. So within the save movie function, we'll create some variables. $valcode equal to jQuery selector of pound field code. That is the unique name of the field where the user typed the code. Comma, because I also want to capture val name equal to pound field name, comma, and also val year equal to pound field year. End of line. So this would capture the complete object, but I only need what the user typed into the field, which is the value. So backing up, actually, we should say .val and .val. That unique code, I don't want any ambiguity because a capital A is different than a lowercase a. So I want to say val code equal to val code dot to uppercase method. Whatever the user type there, force it to uppercase and then save it back on val code. Next, I want to take these separate pieces of data and bundle them as one object, a JSON object. So var a movie equal to curly braces. So PouchDB needs to have an underscore ID field colon, and in this case it's based on val code, comma. The next field we can call m name, movie name, and that's based on val name. And then another field of m year, and that's based on val year. So that's JavaScript object notation as we've seen previously. Curly braces, key and value pairs, commas separate each one until the final key-value pair. You can then do a little console output to see the result of a movie. And so let's say I'm saving AOD, I'll put it lowercase, Army of Darkness from 1992. Save that. Console output says you've got an object of ID AOD, all capital letters, M name, Army of Darkness, and M year, 1992. I want to save this data to the database. We have the ability to bundle this data together, but we don't have really the database active yet. Yes, we've got PouchDB reference on line 75, but we need to activate the database so that then we can start to save this data to the database. So I want to back up. I want to set this up early on, before my splash screen. I want to activate the database. So before my splash screen. I'll create a new variable called db. I won't set it to anything just yet, because I want to create a function, initDB, initialize database. And the secret to activating the database is to reference the database object equal to new PouchDB object. Notice the spelling, capital P, capital DB. We're going to create a new database, a new pouch database. In the parentheses, in quotes, we then have to say the internal name of the database. The user will never see this. I can call this HMovies, horror movies. We can do some console output at this point to see, well, what is that database object anyway? Then we need to return DB. We need to return the result of creating the database back to the larger app. And finally, after defining the initDB function, we have to call initDB. Let's check the result in the browser. So we get some information there. Pouch, name, HMovies, adapter, IDB perhaps. So we've created an internal database, HMovies, using the PouchDB object. Make sure you spell that properly, PouchDB. Google Chrome will let you see this database if you look at the application view. Previously, we looked at local storage. And we had some local storage data. I've still got some data from a previous assignment there. But now inside of the index.db area, we have the HMovies database. And at the moment, there's no data in it. If we look at it by sequence, there's no data yet. Even if I try to save some information here, it won't show up in the database yet. But we're seeing at least through console output that we have created a database. Chrome lets us see it under applications, indexed.db, and then we're going to start to add data to it. So now we've got this DB object, which is our PouchDB, and allows us to do a lot of things, such as storing the data. Back to function save movie. We've got an object of a movie. We want to put that object into the database. After that console output, db.put. We're going to put data into the database. What data? The movie data. Now, pretty much every PouchDB command then returns either a success result or an error result. So we have comma, function. This is an anonymous function. And it's returning either the error object or the success object. I'm going to break that anonymous function so that I can do an if else statement. So you see here, be careful about this complexity. The put method has what data we're putting in, comma, a response function, either an error or success. So if we have a success, do something. If we have an error, do something else. A success result will have us clear the form, and we can say to the console, well, what does success mean? And then to the user, we have a pop-up that we can launch. So as we've seen on a previous exercise, to invoke a pop-up, we reference it and then initialize it as a pop-up. Copy and paste that so that then I can open it. Else is we got an error. And error can be complex because there can be many types of errors that happen as we try to put data into the database. So here, a switch might be the best way to deal with this. So the switch syntax is open and close parentheses because we're checking on a condition, and then open and close curly braces. The switch is that we have error.status. The error object has a status property, and we have a case of 409 that's going to do something, break. We have a case of 412 that'll do something else, break. And if we didn't take all types of errors into account, we have a default case. Something else will happen here, and break. So our switch syntax. Error 409 relates to a movie that already exists. So we have the pop error dupe. We want that to pop up to the user. 412 is that we didn't fill in all the fields, specifically the code field, the unique underscore ID field. And that's pop error code. So that will open. And lastly, we don't know what kind of error happened, so we'll give ourselves some console output, and we'll pass that error object to us in the console so we can check it out, and we'll give the user an alert, error, contact the developer. So all of this is the result of trying to put data into the database. Let's see how that works. I'm going to try to save AOD Army of Darkness from 1992. Save. I get a pop-up, movie saved. I get console output. Object. Form cleared. Object OK true. So this says data was saved to the database. Great. I'll click to close that. Let's say next I want to save the movie FR13, that's Friday the 13th from 1980. Save, I get the visual feedback, I get console feedback, and then if I go over to Chrome Application View, under IndexedDB, PouchH Movies, under by sequence, this shows I have two keys that I've saved so far with values of objects of my data. With another field that I didn't create, ID rev, which is very important, that we'll get to later. Let me save one more item. HA, this is Halloween from 1978, I believe. Save that, movie saved. From my application, I can refresh that view. Now I've got three items in the database. Halloween. Did you also notice that the fields cleared out? Because I'm also invoking the form cleared function. Now my console is going to get very messy, So I'm going to clean it up just a little bit. Success I know works, so I don't need line 125. My clear form, I know I'm clearing it, so I don't need that one. And I don't really need that console output that shows my object. I know that's working. This will be a little cleaner. So this is saving our data so far. So at this point, we've got the ability to put data into the database. Now we need to get data from the database to display it on screen. We have function showMovies, which is activated by clicking the lbtnShow object. All right, so what we're going to do is get the data from the database, process it, and then display it on screen. Step one with PouchDB is to access the DB object and then .allDocs method. This is going to pull out all of the documents in our database in a sort of like a raw format, which we then need to process. I want to include a couple of options. So in JSON format, I'm going to say include underscore docs space colon true. Using all docs will simply retrieve a list of all of the IDs of the object. Remember, every movie object has an underscore ID as required by PouchDB to uniquely identify each movie from every other movie. Well, by saying include docs, we also include the other items of the document, the M name, the M year, and any other field we may have created. So we're saying, yes, include everything, true. Comma, another key value pair. This one is ascending, colon, true. Organize the data that I'm getting out of the database alphabetically from A to Z, 0 to 9, in an ascending order. And like most things in Pouch, we then get either a error result or a success result. So comma function, anonymous function here. We got either an error, comma, or success. Break those curly braces so that we can do an if. If we got a positive result, else we got a negative result. So just to show us here, console log result or console log error. Save that. Run it in the browser. Gonna check out my console, refresh. Okay, so if I hit show, I get an error, of course, because I'm not paying attention here. I'm trying to, if result, well, it's not result we're talking about, it's success. If I did get a success, I could obviously fix this by putting result here. But let's keep it on success. So sorry, we should be checking if success, then console output success object. Now if I refresh this and click show, object total rows 3. If I open that up, we've got rows of data 0, 1, and 2. If I look at 0, there's AOD. If I look at 1, there's FR13. And if I look at 2, there's HA. So they're in alphabetical order based on the ID. And if I look at Chrome's application viewer, in the index.db section, we've got our database, HMovies. And if I look at it by sequence, we've got keys 1 through 3. This was the order in which I saved them. This object is AOD. This object is FR13. And this object is HA. It just so happens that I added them into the database in an alphabetical order, and that my console is displaying them in alphabetical order. Let me add another one. I'm going to add, let's say, code EV1. This is Evil Dead, and this is from 1981. I'm going to save that. Okay, movie saved. Show. I get a result that I've got four items now in the database. Rows of data. Object 1 now is EV1. It used to be FR13. So it is showing it to be in alphabetical order. And if I look at the application, refresh that, I have 1 through 4. The fourth one is EV1, but I'm outputting it in alphabetical order, so EV1 appears before FR13. Okay, so we're getting this raw data out of the database. I need to process it and display it on screen nicely. At this point, we can't really trip the else condition. We can't really cause any error here up to this point. So it's all about success. And we're seeing in the console, we are getting console output. So I'm going to comment that out. What I want to do with this success data is process it in another function. So we're going to say function show movies table. I'm going to show these movies in a table. I'm going to pass into it success. We're seeing that the success object is all of this raw data. But wait a minute, the actual data is in the rows property. The object has an offset property, a rows property, a total rows property, and other things. So in the rows property is where we've got the actual objects. So I want to be more specific and say function show movies table success.rows. Pass the data of the rows in the success object into function show movies table. If you're curious, let me comment that out. And then instead of console log success, we can say success.rows. Run that again. Show. And now we get object, 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 object. So it's more directly to the data rather than the parent object. All right, so I need to define function show movies table. After my show movies function, show movies table, and I need to define this function that I'm passing data into it, so I'll just call it data. Data then is our parameter. And up on line 147, the argument that I'm passing into is the rows of the success object. All right, so what I'm going to do here, I'll create a var string. I'm going to build an HTML string. I'm going to process this data that I'm getting and make it look nice and then display it on screen. So equal to quotes, end quote. I'm going to start a paragraph. End paragraph. I'm then going to start a table. End table. I'll give this table an ID so that I can style it. Here I'm using single quotes. Table movies. So an ID of table movies, and make sure you use single quotes here or else you break this string. I will break the string here and here, and I'll move this down here. So I'm going to add more to this string. Maybe tab this over. All right, so I'm continuing this string. I'm starting here a table row, end the table row. A table is, of course, just rows and columns. So we have our first table in our row. The very first row is made out of th tags, which are table headings. We're going to have a heading of code, a table heading of name, and a table heading of year. These are the three pieces of data that I'm trying to display from my database. Now, this is not complete yet, but just to show that we're on the right track, we have the ldivshow element dot HTML. We want to write some HTML into that div, and the HTML is our string. Let's see how that's working. So I'll save it, refresh it, show. Well, I'm not going to get the data yet. It's too early for that, but I'm showing code, name, year. There's a table here. We haven't styled our table, so it looks pretty invisible. But we've got the column of code, of name, and of year. Thinking ahead, I actually want a fourth column. So if I go back to line 156 and add another th, this is going to be an empty space. So we've got the NBSP, non-breaking space, because I'm going to use that column as my edit column. I want to edit these movies in case I make a mistake. And so what I need to do is loop through all of the data that I'm getting from the database. Now let me change up my code just a little bit. I'm going to end line 156, so I'll put a semicolon there. And so this is stray by itself, which needs to be fixed like this. We're going to add more to the string. In between the start of the table and the end of the table, this is where I'm going to loop. So this will be a for loop. For a certain condition, keep looping. The condition is var I equals 0, I less than data.length, semicolon I plus plus. So I'm saying here, start with the zeroth item in my database and keep looping until I reach the length of the database, which is 4. I've got 4 items in my database so far. I've got 4 items. So loop through it 4 times at the moment. And what I'm doing here is I'm going to add more to the string. I'm going to create another row, another TR. My first TR is my heading. My next table row is the first movie. We've got this time TD, and as a placeholder, I will put here C. We've got another TD, another table data. This one is N, and another TD. This one is Y. And because we've got a fourth column, another TD. This one is E for edit. So these line up. Code and C, name and N, year and Y, and then my blank space to edit. So if I save and run this, I get 4 columns because we've got the code, the name, the year, and the edit. We've got 4 columns because I've got 4 movies saved. Let's say I'm going to save EV2, this is Evil Dead 2, I don't remember the year for it, so I'll just save. And then if I show, now I've got 5 items in the database to show. Well, I need to pull out the actual data that is being saved in these objects. So these were just placeholders, but this is showing that I am then building rows and columns of data. We might not be able to see rows and columns, so for the moment, we will create a basic design of a table and then a nicer design later. All we need to do is add table on line 155 border property to 1. This will give us a simple 1-pixel border. We'll make a nicer one later. So if I show that, there we go. It looks like a table now, right? We'll style it nicer with CSS. We've got rows and columns. The columns are defined by the first row of table headings, and each subsequent row is defined in the for loop. Well, we need to replace these placeholders with the actual data that we've pulled out of the database from function show movies, where function show movies table is processing it. This is a very, very common way of doing things. If you interface, for example, with the Twitter database, it'll give you data in a raw format, which then you need to process somehow. If you interface with the Flickr API, it'll give it to you in a JSON format in raw data, which then you need to process. All right, so we need to be very creative here and very careful with what we do. I'm going to break the string at this point, space plus quote. We don't need that C anymore, and I'm going to move that to its next line. Because this is where I'm going to dynamically say data array dot doc dot underscore ID space plus, and then data I. All right, so we know that data is our raw data, and we've got the zeroth data up to the fourth data. So borrowing I, which at the moment is zero, so we're looking at the zeroth data, doc ID. Okay, what that means is if I show my console output again, back on 146, just for you to understand this, show. We have these objects. Inside of the object, we have doc ID, key, value, and proto. Inside of doc is the actual data. There's underscore ID, m name, m year. So in the object, it's got a property of doc, and in the doc, it's got each key and value. So that's what I'm saying here. Whatever data we're currently at, the 0th one, inside of the doc property, give me the ID and display that under the first table cell. And that's what we're seeing here. If I show, now my columns are filling in with the IDs alphabetically. AOD to HA. I need to do something very similar for name and year. So we've got the end of the first cell, the start of the second cell. I need to do the same thing. Quote plus space quote, don't need that placeholder anymore. Enter there. So now we've got data I dot doc dot m name plus. M name is the other field. Save. Refresh and show, and now we've got the name filling in. Oh, and I see I made a mistake there, so I'll have to fix that later. That's what my edit column is for. Next, the year. So I'm going to break year right there. Delete that Y. Data I doc dot m year plus. The year is filling in. I never filled in a year for Evil Dead 2. I'm going to edit that later. And speaking of editing, that's what my fourth column is. So in this case again, that was just a placeholder. This one does not need to be dynamic. So I'm going to make an icon of a pencil here, ampersand pound X270E semicolon. This displays a pencil. We can look up character codes for various icons. Now I want these icons later on that when I click this pencil, it will let me edit the data of this row. If I click this pencil, it will let me edit the data of that row. So one way to do this is to then put some sort of unique identifier for this pencil. And we can do that with adding a class to this cell, clicking anywhere in this cell with this unique class, BTN pencil, for example, will activate that pencil to be clickable. Doesn't do anything yet. We don't have the JavaScript that triggers that. So this builds up our table, displays it on screen. To get fancy, we can also do a little bit of jQuery. So we're going to say to that element, first hide it, and then fade in, and take 250 milliseconds. So instead of the table suddenly appearing, it'll fade in slowly. So if we show, the table faded in. I would like to style this table before we go much further. First, I'm going to add another class to the empty column, this column here. So backing up to 156, add a class here. We'll call it thEmpty. This is a table heading, but it's empty. This class is here so that we can style it. An ID would have worked fine as well. Now we'll back up to our block of code where we'll write some CSS. Actually, before that, I'm going to remove the border. It's going to go back to sort of an invisible table again so that we can style it nicer with CSS. Just to show that, looks pretty empty. So backing up to our block where we're going to write some CSS, we've got pound table movies. We gave that whole table an ID, table movies. We're going to say background color azure, so a very light blue. Its width will be 100% so that it takes up all the space in that area. Margin auto so that it centers. And what we get out of that is our table spreads out to the size allocated there. We've got a little vague color behind the scenes. Now, word wrap is not quite active yet on this table. So we can do that by adding more properties. We'll say word-wrap is break word. Allow a word to be broken if necessary. Table-layout fixed will give us equal sized columns. And there's a text shadow that's built in to this table, which will say none too. If I show that, we've got four columns of equal size, which now shows the words being broken, but that final column takes up too much space. The way we'll fix that is with another CSS rule, table movies space dot thEmpty. So we're saying there's a class thEmpty and it's inside of table movies. So make sure you've got a space there. What you want to do is set its width to 10%. So now that column only takes 10% of the space, and the other one spread out a little bit more. To be safe that all of these subsequent cells with the pencil also only take 10%, we're going to modify that rule by adding a comma and saying pound table movies space .btn pencil. Adding that comma there says, apply our width to this element as well as that element. I want to align the pencil to the center of the cell. I then want to colorize these different rows so that I can actually see my data. Pound table movies space th. So our very first row is made out of th cells. Background color, you'll be able to choose these colors as you wish, of course. Dim gray. Text color, white. If we've got a dark background, a light foreground then is necessary. So if we show, we've got a dim gray background, white text. There's our first row. We're then going to colorize in alternate colors the following rows. Pound table movies TR. So this is going to colorize a table row. But wait a minute, every row is a TR, so we'll use this pseudo selector colon nth dash of dash type open close parentheses. We're gonna alternate odd and even rows. So by using nth of type odd, we're going to target the alternating rows in this table. We're gonna first add a background color. We can try powder blue. We then need a text color to contrast it, midnight blue. So we've got odd, even, odd, even. The first row is odd, but it's a special case because it has the th tag. And then we've got powder blue alternating. We can do the same thing with even rows. So I'm just going to copy and paste this whole rule here and change it to nth of type even. Our color this time will be sky blue. And we can keep midnight blue as the main text color. So now we've got these alternating colors, which is known as zebra striping. We're making our table easier to read with alternating colors. You'll be able to style this as you wish later on. But there's our CSS code. If you want to fix up these particular sizes, you can figure it out based on what we've already written on the code. But keep in mind, all of this time I've been viewing my results in the console view. If I had it nice and big like that, there wouldn't be a problem. So it depends on the user's size, what you get here. All right, so I want to set this up that I want to edit some of these mistakes. I want to click the pencil to edit a row. Back to our code, to our event handlers section. We had lbtn reset, lbtn save, lbtn show. Now what I want to do is make these buttons clickable. Well, this is different than what we did over here because we were able to define objects at the moment that they existed. When I run my code, the show, save, and reset buttons exist at runtime. You see that as I reset, they exist. So I was able to make JavaScript objects out of them, jQuery objects out of them. These pencils don't exist until I click show, so we need to create an event handler in a slightly different way to target dynamic elements, elements that existed after my first run. So, there should have been a semicolon there. So next, we're going to first target an element that does exist. div show does exist. Dot on, same syntax as before, click. Well, technically they're anywhere that I click on, the div show element will register as an event. So comma quotes dot btn pencil. We've got the edit pencil as a sort of further target. We've got this element, btn pencil, inside of this element, btn show. Once that element has been clicked, comma, run the function fn update movie. Now our syntax here is a little bit different, because this is actually much more complex. We have a class that is applied to many of these movies. So we need to pass an argument into function update movie. Actually, function update movie prep. We need to do a little preparation first. Function, open close, curly brace, and curly brace. Now be careful here. Make sure that these curly braces encompass function update movie prep. In order for us to pass properties into a function, we've seen previously, we need to wrap an anonymous function around it first. And let's think about what we're about to do. We've got a pencil attached to every row. If I click on this pencil, it relates to the AOD row. If I click this pencil, it relates to the FR13 row. So we have the jQuery selector of this. Now this can get pretty hairy, so make sure you've got your parentheses like me. Dollar parentheses and inside parentheses this. That means this object that I clicked on, this particular pencil that I clicked on. Well, that's the object itself of the pencil. I need the data of the whole row. So we'll add dot parent, open close parentheses. So we're saying, let's target the parent object of the particular object I've clicked on. That would basically be the whole row of the particular pencil we clicked on. We need to define function update movie prep. So we'll back up. Function fn update movie prep, open close parentheses, open close curly brace. And what we've done is we've passed data into the function. So it's this obj, this object, all of the data that we pass into it. And if we're curious, console log, what is this obj composed of? We can take a quick look in the browser to see our result. Show, click any pencil. We have a row. Okay, click another pencil. We have another row. Specifically, if we open that up, that particular row is all of this data. And we're going to see various aspects of the data. If I clicked on that final row there, I get a different row with its own data. Basically, inner HTML. And there's the row of actual raw data. Same thing with any of these others. So we're basically referencing the whole row of data. And our preparation is, I want to edit a row, but I have to refer to the particular row. So then in our code, we will further target it. So our preparation function update movie prep is all about getting ready to edit a particular row. I want to click on this row so that I get a pop-up to edit the data of this row. That's what I'm preparing for. that pop-up will be a jQuery mobile pop-up box. So we need to back up and actually create that pop-up before we display it. Just like we had these pop-ups on line 81 to display simple pop-ups, we can create something similar to create a more complex pop-up. So after those divs, create another div here. This will be a more complex one, so I'll separate it into multiple lines. Data role, pop-up. This one is a data dialog equals true, and it has an ID so we can reference it. Pop movie update. It'll have a header, so it's going to be like a mini screen, much more than the other pop-ups. Data role, header, h1 here, and we'll say updating. It's going to say updating EVD1, updating HA. It's going to say updating whatever one we've clicked on. In order for that to be dynamic, then it needs an ID or some unique identifier. H1 update. The main visible part of the screen is an article. Role of main, class, UI content. And then we will display some dynamic content here. So a div with an ID of div edit. I want to make this pop-up appear, and it's going to show the data I'm going to change. So back to our prep. Function movie prep. Let's just see if that pop-up pops up. So pound pop movie update dot pop-up. That initializes it as a pop-up, and then we actually open it. So if we check our result, we show our data, you click on any pencil, you get a pop-up, which is incomplete because there's not much to display. That's another one. That's another one. So we're making a pop-up appear, and this pop-up will include the data that we're editing. I need a close button on that box, so we'll go back to our pop-up before the header. We'll have a close button, which we'll wrap an A tag around. href pound home, because we're in this home section. Data rel back, it'll take us back to the home section. And then we'll style this with a class. UI-BTN space UI-corner-all space UI-shadow space UI-icon-delete. That'll be an X space UI-BTN-icon-no-text so that that closed text does not appear. And then UI-BTN-write. So this is going to create a close button at the top right corner of the pop-up. I click a pencil, I get a pop-up, I get close. So I need to build this div and display it in the pop-up. Back to our prep. We're seeing that we are able to retrieve a particular row of data. I'm going to comment that out. I want to create some variables that hold the individual pieces of data I'm trying to edit. We'll have $tempcode. We'll have $tempname. $tempyear. These will hold the value of the particular item in the particular cell, in the particular column, in the particular row. Equal to this obj. Remember, this obj encompasses a whole row. Dot find dot text, comma. So give me the text of a particular item in this row. This row is defined as this object, this obj. We're going to find, in quotes, td. We're targeting a particular cell, colon, eq, open close parentheses, 0. This is a way of saying a cell that equals 0. In our row, we've got our table row, and we have inner HTML, basically. We have 0, 1, 2, and 3. So give me the text of what's in the zeroth cell of this row. Comma, do the same thing here. From this object, find something, give me the text, comma. The something is a cell that equals the first cell, 0, 1. And then next, this obj, find something dot text, and in this case, td equal to 2, the second index, or the third item in the row. And one more, we have l div edit. That's equal to the object pound div edit, that placeholder that we have in that pop-up. Next, we're going to build a string, empty at the moment. We'll add to it some input fields. Type text, placeholder, AOD, for example, an ID of field update code, just so that it's more readable. I'm going to then break this to the next line. Another input field, type text, placeholder, army of darkness, and an ID of field update name. Plus, to the next line, another input, type number, placeholder, year, ID, field update year, plus, finally, a button. End of line there. The button will say update movie, and it has an ID, so we can reference it via JavaScript, btn update. Take this string and display it on screen under the l div edit object, process html, the string. So I'm going to display that string in that div in that pop-up. Refresh that, show my rows, click on any row, I get the pop-up. I'm updating something. Once I click the update movie, the changes will then get applied to the table. I'm still preparing this. I also want to change what's in the header. So we have the pound h1 update. We can write new HTML there. I want it to say updating. Temp code. whatever particular row I've clicked on, I want that to be displayed up on the header. Updating AOD, updating HA, updating EV2. And what these placeholder boxes are about is take the data of the particular row I've clicked on, put it into these cells so that there's a starting point. When I click update movie, then make a change. So next line, notice I have the pop-up appear as the last items. We have pound field, update code, dot val, temp code. Pound field update name dot val temp name and pound field update year val temp year. So if I click on any one of these rows, they get a pop-up and these items get filled in. So we're updating this movie and these items fill in. The point of this is I misspelled Army of Darkness. So if I click on that, I want to properly spell darkness. Click update and it'll update it. But that's our preparation. We can make an animation here instead of it simply appearing, by adding a little bit more to our open. So we'll say comma with a JSON object of options. We're going to say position to window, so it appears in the center of the window, comma, transition, colon, we'll do flip. We get a flip animation. All right, so all of that was prep. Next, I want to be able to click the button of update to actually update things. I need another event handler. I've got the preparation set up. This one won't be as complex, but I still need the selector like this. Div edit dot on click pound btn update. Afterward, run function update movie. Notice the syntax is different. Line 236 needed to be complex because we're passing data into the function. The data is already waiting for us with function update movie prep, so now we can actually run function update movie. So after the update prep function, we create the function update movie. By clicking on the pencil, we take that data and put it temporarily into the boxes. Most likely the data in those boxes, those input fields, have been changed. That's why the user clicked the pencil. So then we need to retrieve the latest versions of the data in those fields to use to update the movie. So var update code, it's the updated version of the code, retrieving field update code, the val. Then we get the update name, same way, field update name, the val, and update year, pound field update year, the val. End of line. In order for us to update an existing record in the PouchDB database, we need to reference it by its ID, which is update code. And then we need to also state that this is a new revision, a new version of the data in the database. So first, db.get. We need to make sure that there is that particular object in the database that we're trying to get. Update code. That's the underscore ID field of a particular record. Trying to get that will, of course, create the result of either error or success. If else to deal with that. This time we'll do if error. If we get an error, give me some console output and tell me what that error is, and then alert to the user. For the moment, just a simple error. Else, there was no error. So if there's no error, we can then go off and do db.put into our database, into our PouchDB database. We're going to put data into the database. So the same put was found when we were first storing the data in the database back on line 159, putting the movie into the database for the first time. Now, based on the existing movie, we're going to put the data back into the database, but updated. So put, we have update code, update name, update year. That'll be a JSON formatted object, and which I will split like that and say underscore ID colon. That'll be success.underscore ID. Recall that success is the success object. If we successfully checked that there is a record, a movie to update, well, let's put the same ID back into the database, comma. Then we're changing the M name to be our current update name, and M year to be our current update year. And then underscore rev. There's a new revision, a new version of this data, and that comes from success dot underscore rev. So if we are dealing with the ID that we think, replace the name and the year and give it a new revision number. All of that is in the curly braces of that object, comma, function, that itself has a possible error or success. Break that apart. If else, we'll do it again as in checking for an error first. We could be checking for success. We would just need to flip these two. But we're saying if we get an error, console that out so that I can try to deal with it and alert to the user a big old scary error. Else then is our success. What we want to do is we've got a pop-up that's currently open. Pop movie update. We then want to close it. And show movies the latest version of the table. So if we managed to update our data, reload the table, or else it doesn't look like we've made a change. Let's give it a shot. Show. Still working as before. Good. I'm going to click the first cell. Pops up. That was working as before. Let's say I want to properly spell darkness. How do you spell darkness? Two S's. Update. It updated. I want to add a year to Evil Dead 2, so I click that. There's no year. I believe it was in 86, maybe 87. Update, it updated. So the pop-up gets closed, the data gets refreshed. Let's do something crazy here. I want to change our scheme here, ed2 instead of ev2, update. I get an error. Click OK. Our console is saying status 404 not found, message missing. The quirk of this is that we cannot change the code data. The way we've got it set up here is if I want to change HA and make it HAL, well, there does not exist an HAL item in the database. The database has these objects that exist here, and none of them is named HAL. So that error is saying you're trying to change something that doesn't exist. For our current purposes, we're going to make it easy on ourselves and say we will not allow the user to change the code, because it's sort of like the Tom and Jerry cartoons where Tom is trying to get Jerry and he's sawing a plank that he's standing on himself. So here, if I try to edit EV1 into something else, I'm cutting the plank beneath my feet. And it doesn't let me. It doesn't exist. So I'm going to prevent myself. I'm going to prevent the user from editing this field. I only will let them edit the name field and the year field. We could figure out a way to edit the name field by doing much more work, in which we have to temporarily store the code field, then the one that they're trying to update, create a brand new item in the database, and delete the old item in the database. More trouble than it's worth at the moment. So we'll simply disable the ability to edit the code field. Back on our code, that requires then, when we're creating the, on line 216, when we're creating the update code, to make sure that people don't edit it, we will add the disabled property. It's just by itself disabled. It's not like disabled equals true. It's just disabled, space, hidden. What that does is then no longer can the person change the code because it's not even available for them to edit anymore. It'll still say you're updating AOD and you can make changes. But there's no way to edit those. Those are there. If the person made a mistake, we will have the ability to delete it completely soon, but right now we're just editing. And notice technically I can click the pencil, make no changes, click edit movie, and it will edit it. Technically it's a new version of the code, but it's exactly the same. So if I wanted to capitalize that, changes it. We have then the ability to edit the data. Okay, let's talk about deleting the data of a particular row. We'll make this one much easier. We'll create a delete button below our table so that then the person can choose which they want to delete, and it'll delete it. Back to our code, to the spot that we started to display the table, back on line 200 or so. We've got that for field. After our table, let's add more to the string. In a new paragraph, with a little bit of CSS styling, class UI body B. That's a little bit of jQuery mobile, actually. We will have an input of type text. Placeholder AOD to let people know that's what they should type in there. A size of 10 characters. An ID of field delete space. Then a button. A button that makes something happen, which is delete movie. And that needs an ID of btn delete. So we're adding that before the moment that we show the string on screen. What happens is we show the table, and below it, there's an area to delete a movie. So our theory is we will type HA, doesn't matter uppercase or lowercase, because then we will process this as uppercase. We click delete, and it's going to delete a particular row. So we need to make that button active to capture what the person wrote there to delete a row. That'll be another event handler. We've got button pencil, button update. We'll do another one. In the div show, we have on, click, pound btn delete. Run the function fn delete movie. So we'll define function fn delete movie var to capture the value of the value the code. It comes from the field delete. The value there. We need to force val the code to uppercase, just in case they didn't type it in uppercase. In order for us to delete something from the database, we need to first make sure that we can get that item from the database. The item is val the code. And the result is, again, an error or success if else. If we get success, meaning there is a movie in the database that exists, let's remove it. Or else there isn't a movie, so give an error. Let's do the error part first. If there's an error, if that movie that we're trying to delete doesn't exist, console output to see what that error is for ourselves. And then we've got a pop-up. Pop error null. Set that up as a pop-up first. And then open it. Display an error message if that class we're trying to delete doesn't exist. Let's check if that movie is there first. So if I refresh this, show. If I don't type anything in here and simply click the button, error, movie does not exist. Great. Now, if I'm trying to delete AOD, no result because I didn't fully program that yet, but that's the success happening. If I'm trying to delete AOD2, delete doesn't exist. Okay, so in success, we have DB remove. But we can't directly remove from the database until we check if that object exists in the database. And what we're trying to remove is success. Sounds odd, but basically that object that we're trying to delete, that's what we're deleting, which has a function with a further error or success with a further if else. And if that was success in deleting or error in deleting, that error at this deep level of DB remove, I can reuse the same else portion from the DB.get. But if we're as far as db.remove, there should not be an error this deep. It would have already been caught at the first else from db.get. If we did remove it, well, we need to redraw the table. Function show movies, so that the table shows the latest movie information. I also want a pop-up to let people know pop deleted. I want to let people know that we did successfully delete the movie in question. So let's see the result. If I'm trying to delete movie AAA, okay, it doesn't exist. But if I'm trying to remove movie AOD, delete, it deleted it, it redrew the table, and it made the pop-up, movie deleted. Because perhaps that should be EV3, Army of Darkness, 1992. Save. Show. It's now in the database. So that I don't have to click Show explicitly after save, why not also draw the table as soon as I save? With function Show Movies, that shows my movies, why not after we save a movie? So going all the way back to save movie, after putting a movie successfully, clear the form, show the movies, and the pop-up. So now when I save a movie, it will automatically show the latest table. So let's say I want to save EX, that was the Exorcist. I'm probably misspelling that. I can fix it later. I don't remember the year on that. Save it. Pop up. And the table automatically appears. I want to edit that. 1967? I don't remember the year on that one off the top of my head. Updated it. Let's say, well, I don't even want it into my database until I fix it, so I can delete. I can do lowercase, I can do multiple uppercase, lowercase, but we've got two uppercase, so it automatically does it, refreshes, deletes. So we've got saving movies, retrieving movies, editing movies, deleting movies. The final step is to delete the whole database in case we want to start over completely. All right, so function delete movie works. Next, we need a mechanism to delete the database. We started that over on our options screen, delete all data. So what we want to do is make that button active and also a double check to make sure the user really wants to delete everything. Maybe we'll call it delete all movies. So that was back on the section of options. If we go back to our code, we will look for our section options. That's where we're saying delete all data. We'll say delete all movies. And that has an ID of BTN nuke. So we need an event handler. This one isn't so complex at all. We'll say pound BTN nuke on click run function nuke. We need a new function. Function fn nuke will make a pop-up confirmation happen where the user can either approve the deletion of the data or cancel. So this will be a switch statement, a switch in which we have a few cases, a true that they want to delete, a case of false, where they don't want to delete, and a default case, as is common practice for a third result. What we're going to evaluate in the switch is a confirm pop-up. We have the alert pop-up. We have the prompt pop-up, we have the confirm pop-up. We're going to display a message. You are about to delete everything. New line, confirm. So this will make an obvious pop-up appear, where then they can confirm or deny. The pseudocode might not work completely, but let's give it a shot. Go to the options, delete all movies, pop up. You are about to delete everything, confirm, cancel. If I click OK, that'll go over to the true case. If I cancel, that goes over to the false case. And there's a third option. You know, if we close it up here, that's actually the same as false. So we never really get to the third option, which is the default option. So for the third option, we can just say console third error. If we had a false, well, if they canceled, we don't really need anything to happen. We can give ourselves some console output here and say delete canceled. The true is the part where something really happens. db.destroy. We've got the destroy method of PouchDB. Our database, we're about to destroy it. This one doesn't take any parameters, but it has a callback function again of either error or success. Dealing with if else here, as always. Let's do error first. If there's an error, let me know in the console. What was that error? And then alert to the user. Error. Deleting database. Or else there was a success. We need to init DB again. We need to reinitialize our database. If we deleted the database, we need to reinitialize the database to start to save more data to the new database. And then I want to fade out ldiv show dot show dot fade out 2 seconds. I want to see the data fade away to oblivion in 2 seconds. All right, so I'm going to reload my code. I have data in my database. Delete all movies. You're about to delete everything. I got cold feet. Cancel. Delete canceled. My data's still there. Okay, I really do want to delete it. Delete all movies. Click OK. The data's gone. I can start adding data again, and I'll just add some gibberish data at the moment just to save some data. There's the data again. Add some more data. There it is. Go back up to delete movies, confirm that, close that, it went away. So there's my project. About 327 lines of code or so, where we're able to save data to a database, retrieve data, edit data, delete the data. It's powered with jQuery mobile to give it a nice interface. This is the horror movie database powered by PouchDB. Based on what we learned here, you're going to create a final project. Be on the lookout on Blackboard for the details. And you're going to create a very cool final project based on what we've learned here. So this has been Victor Campos for CIS 165 JavaScript programming. Take care.